thank you all for coming. And this is the most terrific, second most terrific day traveling across the city. Maybe escalated because the president was sworn. And the beginning of the week, a lot of people asked people to come because they were still over in England at the funeral. So I came to the Shamans clinically yesterday. In any event, because the subway works well. I'm an orthopedic surgeon, but I also do research, some basic research on this disease. And so through this, I'll be sprinkling clinical aspects, some few basic science, lesions, the more epidemiologic and clinical follow-up information we have on the clinical trials with the drug. And then I have a series of cases showing kind of complexity. It's not always a simple, straightforward path in how to approach this disease or when to do certain things. So it takes what I'm referring to as a balanced approach to it. And I think that will come out of it as we work our way through. My disclosures, a consultant for the Sankyo, the company that makes Textart and Geraldinol, and also for Stryker, which is an orthopedic company that makes joint replacements and fracture stuff. So none of that is directly involved in the presentation, although the Geraldinol will come up in the course of the discussion. As Pexidart. Background you're all very familiar with. This is a very rare neoplasm affecting the synovium, but also sometimes outside of the joint in just the other mesenchymal tissue. And the estimates, again, for epidemiology differ. The nodular form is maybe 10 times as frequent as the diffuse form, but diffuse form about to be as low as 700 a year in the United States, or maybe as many as 2,000, but it's in that bracket. And this is actually very important because, and back to the question about this being metastatic disease or cancer, 15 years ago I had a grant submitted to the NIH that was very highly rated, easy fundable rank. There's a second level of analysis. Go through political analysis, and the conclusion was that this was a rare disease, it wasn't a cancer, it didn't affect people, and genetic change in the treatment, which is what my proposal was for, was too dangerous to, although that was wrong, but that was their assumption, so it was not funded. And so for a long time, we were blocked because of the rarity of it, because it's an orphan process. And even people who wanted to do research in it were blocked for these different reasons. And so this whole organization and the work that Cindy has done and all of you are part of is exceptionally important to maintain visibility to this. And so I thank you for that. And I hope we'll be able to make further progress as a result. The classic treatments and quote, gold standard, although as you can see it's rather tarnished. The gold standard is surgery. If you can cut it out, cut it out. And for all of the problems associated with it over half the time, and some optimists who don't follow the patients for very long will say that it will work for 80% or 90% of cases, but that is, I guess you have to be a real optimist to work in oncology. So, but there also is a reality to it that you need to be aware of. So, very high recurrence rate is highlighted here, and Dr. Stern spoke to you about the introduced tyrosine kinase. So this is, not to get too squeamish, but this is a picture of one such case that I removed. I think there are some very important things in the gross appearance. Let's call it gross, but that come through here. You look at this. So what color is this? So what is the name of this other? Use the old name for it, pigmented bilodontosis sclerosis. What is the pigment in there?
Oh. Red.
Rust.
Red, yellow, some white, dark brown, orange. So often it looks like mud. Or so it's a whole spectrum of chocolate colors from a deep bald black to very milk chocolate, even on that. But these yellow portions, largely the histiocytes, these foamy cells that both are reactive to and maybe producing of that CSF1 that Dr. Stern just mentioned. And so this is a very heterogeneous disease. It's not uniform. So this is one of the things that kind of plagues the whole research process. Which part of this do you study? Which of those cells are going to be the indicative ones, the drivers for how do we target it? Maybe Dr. Schwartz will be covering some of this even later. So maybe Dr. Stern did some already. But as few as 2% of the cells in the tumor are actually driver cells that have the mutations and have the abnormality. And the other ones are incited to riot. So there are a few rabble rousers, and the other cells incited to riot are the effectors of the problem. And so, and this has been called in some certain ways, the landscape effects. Some of the drivers don't actually do the dirty work. So again, which ones are you targeting if you're going to make an impact on it? Some cases have as many as 20% of the cells that are drivers in this sense. So part of the heterogeneity in response has to do with the mixture. You're talking about a 2% deal or a 20% deal, an order of magnitude difference, and the result varies accordingly. And it leads to one of the conclusions, and so later on I'll talk about it, part of what I call a sandwich approach, beating down the disease, some the drug, cut it out so you get down to a very small number of cells that may have enough drivers to actually drive things. And so, but this is still the using it, but it's somewhat theoretical. Imaging, yes.
Do you mind
so please
questions or do you want to
start? Oh no, go ahead. I love it. And because there's only a certain amount that I could put in and I wasn't, again, with the other people either in traffic or in the OR to make sure we cover all these features. So
going back to your first line on the background as it relates to gynecell tumor and increased morbidity. Can you talk to us a little bit about what that contributes to? Is it falls? Is it, common surgical complications?
A lot. It's pain. Stiffness is one of the major complaints. And I'll talk about just this publication 3 weeks ago about the pain aspects of it. But stiffness is a big deal. So between the pain and the stiffness, often swelling, so depends on which joints, how it affects range of motion, or it's in your ankle, or your foot, you can't get into a shoe. So there's a whole spectrum of symptoms based on the anatomic distribution. Right? But often the discussion centers around the knee because 50 to 60% of the cases are of the knee. And so the other people are the poor stepchildren, or lack of step children in the process because of the small numbers of cases and the lack of organized population. But in any event, the pain runs from just occasional and activity related. It's only when I have to do subway stairs or garden or, you know, toward the end of the day, running around after my kids all day. Or one of the most profound ones that I have seen is a young woman that she was carrying her baby and falling on the stairs. And so it was not just for her, it was for her baby. So this was very moving to me, and an incentive for treatment in situations. So in the end, it translates to your question in terms of deciding the treatment and the balanced approach. It's how does that affect the individual? So even though here I'm going to talk about the x-rays or the imaging, I've never cured an x-ray or an MRI in my life. Many patients, but never an x-ray or an MRI. These are roadmaps. These are guidance. They're informative, but they're not the end product of what we're looking at. So, and so it affects, and so we've studied this, and it affects work. So, you know, a third of people miss work different times. 20% spend a lot of time in physical therapy and different things that's helped some, but obviously they don't cure the disease. Maybe make it more functional, managing better. But it's expensive, and for a chronic disease, it's not like you just had an operation, maybe you go to physical therapy and you overcome it in a month or 3 months and then you're back to your baseline. This is a chronic disease and you have how much and how long. And your insurance, if you have it, is limited. And you get 12 treatments and then you're on your own system. That's what they tell you. So in any event, I don't have it's not a simple answer to your question, but it reflects the spectrum. And the fact that on average, people have had the limitation of the symptoms for 3 years before it's identified. So they struggle with it, and they get some half-baked or well-meaning diagnosis or attempt at it. And it doesn't show up early on x-ray, so you get that on the back, tough it up. So it's and this cuts the point, how do you diagnose it? Well, the pigment, if it is pigmented, but you saw it varies, and some of them have very little pigment, and some have a lot, in mud, black. So what is that pigment? It's a metabolite of iron that is lodged in the tissue with tenosynovial, and it alters the number of free electrons, and so on. So you can't see the pigment on an x-ray. But on an MRI, it causes a change. And any metal causes a change. But it gives this black picture. Let me see. There's an asterisk. A black area, which is the area of the tumor. But because of the imbalanced electrons, it has a proximity. If you do the MRI with the proper sequences, that's the issue. It creates what's called a blooming artifact. So it'll be 25% bigger in that black hole than what the actual tumor is. And but that requires a special sequence that is, if you go your orthopedic doctor, your general practitioner, or an MRI of your knee because they think you have a common problem, which is a tear in the meniscus, and so they order it for sequences that are perfect to look for meniscal pathology. But it misses this entirely because it's not what's called a gradient echo image. It's contributes to delayed diagnosis of the problem. It's also an issue if you're looking for recurrent disease, right? You need to, or the doctor has to be aware enough of it to ask for the gradient echo image, not just the regular classified disease based on how the settings go, T1 or T2 weighted. It doesn't necessarily require contrast, by the way, but I think it's helpful. So I generally do it at my slow getter. When I change my hat and go across the street to the hospital for special surgery, they don't use contrast, or very rarely do, because they have some fancy things to try to get around. But this whole metal issue is important, because people with this disease often have surgery, and they may even have joint replacement. And so they may have a big wad of metal in it. So that compromises what you can see with MRI. It also produces this kind of artifact. And then, do you have enough for your case where you think it's just other stuff related to the joint replacement, but it's actually recurrence? And so which raises the whole issue of, some people say, well, it's not worth doing surgery or doing a drug. If it gets bad enough, then I can just take this out and replace the joint. But if you actually look at any series of 15 patients or more where this has been done, 80% recurrence rate after joint replacement with this disease. So it's not the solution. So the black holes, this is a, you can see on the left, the shadow of the metal hip replacement. Right, that's outside the bone and then the soft tissue, which is the tumor, and it has the same black hole. There are a lot of other conditions that could mimic this, and there's been a whole, menu of different benign ones. And so the doctor's got to sort through that, and getting the correct diagnosis, we talked about delay and the different techniques or the difficulties with that, but getting the right diagnosis is important. Then you're on the correct road. The most dangerous thing about it is going down the wrong road. You heard a nice presentation earlier about the CSF1 inhibitors and the inhibitors of the receptor. And so this picture is called kinome. So again, Dr. Stern told you about the these tyrosine kinase inhibitors. So here they put them all on a wheel and then try to use the drug to see which ones age effects. And so imatinib, one of the drugs commonly used, is on the left, and all of the red spots where it interferes in direct. And so they're limited, it's not all of them, but there are a lot of them. Whereas what was called at that time PLX3397, which is pexidartinib, which is Duralio, and a much smaller, tighter distribution, fewer areas. So that's part of why you want to use that drug as opposed to imatinib, not to mention it's now going to be approved. And imatinib is for other diseases. Thank goodness, it's not a godsend, and it's okay. So, how does it work? Well, in our long-term follow-up in a randomized trial of the pexidartinib, about two-thirds of patients get a substantial shrinkage of their tumors. All comers, all locations get randomized. That was 25 weeks of analysis. It's basically a half a year. And following about for 2 years, during two-thirds of the patients. And that's the shrinkage of the tumor. Some people get dramatic responses as soon as 2 weeks, 15 days. So that's really remarkable. Nothing else. But so these, this graph, here, I published this last month in Clinical Orthopedics, which looks at the change in pain in patients on the y-axis and the size of the tumor on the x-axis. And the black dots are the drug, and the white ones, circles, are the placebo. And you see, that's really all of the patients who are on drug, smaller decreased tumor size, reduction in pain. Now, perhaps it was a mistake, or being super honest, or having unrealistic expectations. But in the beginning, we set the threshold to what constituted a significant response very high. So that means it was only, the p-value was 0.52. So it didn't make statistical significance, whereas 0.5 was what was needed. So this is like, so we shot ourselves in the foot. So in the articles and in the publications, we have to be strictly honest with it and say it didn't achieve a statistical significant difference. But I think if you look at the raw data, that's why I show you the raw data, how all the patients are in that left lower quadrant, and basically none of the placebos were, some of them have more pain. This is obviously very busy. It's called the spider plot. But here, the green ones, so this is following individual patients, what each individual person did. The green ones are the treated with active drug, and the red ones are the placebos. So in this instance, down is good, down is less pain, down is better function, down the analogous thing for stiffness back to what are the symptoms and limitations. So, and I think just the raw shock test to look at this and say that's a real response. We've just completed a prospective 2-year trial to pick up all the new patients we could in Europe and the United States. So I have the most of the patients in the United States on this trial. And we follow them. Didn't dictate treatment, just see what happened to them over the course of time. And it's in the different anatomic distributions, like 20 in the knee, 18 in the ankle, 12 in the hip, 26 other sites. So a little bit we're saying all each site is the same, but to help analyze the data, it's here. And so you can see in gray, the middle bar there, that there are patients who only had surgery and that was it. And then the greenish one is those who had only medicine. And the bottom group, which is the most number of people, but we're going to watch and wait. We're going to see what happens, see what your symptoms are, see what the disability is, see how it's affecting your life. And whether you have stairs or you have to carry a baby or it's your right driving leg and you can't drive to get to work to do whatever you need. But, so this is the spectrum which we just published also. But please, if anyone else has questions, stop me and or stop me from rambling and bring me back to you.
I have a question.
Yep.
When, after surgeries, my daughter's had two, do they do a pathology on the tumor and get
absolutely
any? Yeah, I've never heard.
How thorough it's done varies in different pathology departments, and I think most are very capable.
Mm-hmm.
But absolutely.
But what are the findings? Are they like, oh, this one was darker, and then,
They don't describe that.
No.
That part. They say it comes out consistent with TGCT.
Okay.
Now, sometimes it's infiltrated into muscle or infiltrated into bone, mm-hmm, or erosion of cartilage. They'll describe that. They do just once over gloss over regarding those other heterogeneous things that I think are important. They don't do specialized tests. They don't do any of the genetic tests. They don't do something called flow cytometry that looks for abnormal amount of DNA or something that you can pick up some things. So they don't do any of those tests unless they have a visual microscopic suggestion that there's something.
There's a question.
no more, how many neurons? So cancers have a lot more cells crammed into a small space. And the other ones are more relaxed, laid back, stretching. And then you look how bizarre they are, the nucleus and how that stains. So they have criteria for it. And sometimes there are other things. There aren't lots of visible mitoses, which are cells dividing in this disease. But you need to link ones, not so many that you can see. And then the other findings they look for are if there's necrosis and dead tissue, where the tumor's grown so fast it's unstable, its blood supply, so it dies. So you see that. That can happen for lots of reasons, not just cancer. But I know those. And finally, sometimes they can see tumor in a blood vessel, which is suggesting it's catching the drain up that gas inside. So they would suggest. Anyway, I'll skip this. Just the different kinds of surgery we've had in that 2 years. And then I thought I'd show you a few examples of how complicated it is in different situations and how it's dealt with. So, in these three cases I just presented last week at our international meeting for tumors and cancer. But a little busy, but following it left to right and color coded. So, the green things are. Those are initial symptoms, different therapies like physical therapies, orange. If you've got MRIs, it's the dark purple or black. And when you've got systemic treatment, numbers, drug treatments, it's in the lighter blue. Surgery is the darker blue. But this is, and then I'll show you what the answer is. This is somebody who had new symptoms, didn't know what the problem was, had restriction of his hip. He thought it was a sports injury, he had pain when he was running, he's 29. And so they sent him to physical therapy. His insurance wouldn't pay for an MRI without having gone through therapy first. And so he horsed around with this and got nowhere and got worse. And then finally got the MRI in December 2019. And lo and behold, you'll see, there's a big honking tumor from his hip into his lower pelvis. And so then he went on drug. This is a lower dose of drug in Dr. Schwartz's theory. Some about drug and some other things, but we've gone to so this is at the lower dose to start, which is one of the modifications that's often used in our effort to minimize the side effects and increase safety. And so you're doing well, no problems. And so they bumped them up to the regular dose. So that's a little light blue box. And then he had a follow-up MRI and showed dramatic shrinkage of this, which you'll see. So then he could get a total hip replacement. So now he's doing great. And then afterwards, he went back on drug to try to keep the thing from coming back. And he has done that. And this is a tiny bit of disease. His symptoms are gone following the disease. And that's where it is as of the summer. I know you're not radiologists, so it's hard to describe, but especially, was there a pointer?
It should be on there. It wasn't responding earlier.
Oh, let's go over here. Show. But, so, yeah, on to the right. So there, these yellow arrows. So this is looking at him, and it's your hip bone on the side, hip joint is down here, this is centrally in the pubic bone. And so this, beautiful, thank you. But that black thing, that's his tumor. You can't even see his hip there. And so anyway, so that was the beginning. This is after he got taxi, and that tumor, all that stuff, shrunk down, very little left, he got his hip replaced. Which is here, and so that's the black of the metal of the hip, replacement, but there's a tiny bit of tumor, but that's, easy to manage, and these symptoms are gone, and he's a happy guy, and you have to convince him not to run, because it's silly, especially if you have a hip replacement at age 29. This is an example of, again, what I call that sandwich approach. Shrink it down, cut it out the best you can, and then top it off and follow. Here's a case in the foot, and I'll not go through the whole thing in short. Yes, please.
What's the logic behind doing the sandwich approach as opposed to just surgery and then medication after?
Because I can't. If this, for real cancer, I cut all the way around it, through normal tissue, what's called en bloc or with a margin, a negative margin. For this, you're kind of scooting along the edge. There are, first, you saw how difficult it can be to identify what the edge is, grossly. And I don't want to cut it because if it's truly a benign disease, I don't want to cut out his femoral nerve, so then he can't straighten his leg or get up off the toilet or climb the stairs.
So
I'll even compromise it and maybe have some cells that are still there and hope that, you know, it's the 2% out of 2% and it's not going to drive things, and then we can clean up any problems with the drug.
I think maybe what she meant was, why would you do it for like 3 months before, then remove it, then go on it again instead of just have surgery and then go on it? I think maybe was what you meant.
Oh,
was that, yeah. So why the pre-treatment?
Well, that shrunk it down. That was a very hard operation to take out that big mass around the main blood vessels coming from the pelvis, and again, this femoral nerve that is how you kick field goals and get off the toilet. Or up and down off the floor. If you're yesterday patient, she's a nursery school teacher. So she's and be up and down these things. Yes.
So I'm one of those people where I was on the drug, you did my total replacement, and I got very mixed. So Dr. Tapp was like, no, don't go back on the drug after your surgery, and you were like, I'm a former football player, go back on the drug and not now, which I did, I took your counsel. And so is that becoming the standard of care? Because I was early on, there's not a lot of data.
There still aren't a lot of data, and back to the question, but what are they looking for microscopically? And so a couple of the patients who gone through that and took it out, it was totally wiped out, and there ended up only something called xanthoma cells, which is kind of weird. Good, but weird. And others where it looked the same as normal, just these less. I believe it's what should be done. Standard, I don't know, depends how many talks I get, as to how standard it becomes. But, sorry, I know we've got to move along.
But, no, you're okay.
But I think these are questions, this is our Q&A. We had a trial with a company that I designed that we're going to do it, but they pulled their support for it because at this time they wanted to get the drug approved across the board. If there were an ongoing trial out there, the FDA wouldn't consider approving it for the regular method, the routine portion. Furthermore, two of my patients and two out of the first five that I was doing with this, they got so much better from the drug, they said, I don't want surgery. So that totally eviscerated the study, and so the company would not support that because it was going to be a study that wouldn't work. So, do other people do it? Well, to do it, you need a team. You need, I need to work with Dr. Schwartz, with Dr. Tapp, and he needs to work with me. And so you need a team to collaborate on it. There aren't that many such teams. There are more. Anyway, this is a case that I won't go through the details, but that surgery came roaring back, big problem, could get in the shoe, went on drug, improved. It didn't shrink much, it didn't meet criteria by the design of the enlightenment study for the drug, but it did meet criteria for eliminating her pain and getting into a shoe. And so she said, I'm not having surgery. And so she just stayed on drug. So this is another approach. You can start with one thing and you go to another, you adapt. This is guerrilla warfare. It's bob and weave and adapt to the circumstances and not one size fits all. And this is just a picture. And then under the knee, back and forth, failed and that did. Pexi had side effects, went off of it, disease came roaring back. Then he came back and said, I want to go on Pexi because I was better on that. Anyway, so we can go through all of that. And so there are all these complications that can occur, adverse side effects, some more serious than others. And this is just, it's in the elbow. Also the sandwich treatment, that's been good for her long term. I talked already about monitoring, we have another device in place. And so this gentleman has hip replacements for pain as of the hip. Did well for 18 years, his hip was wearing out, and with hip replacement, every step he takes actually releases 100,000 submicron particles of polyethylene, which is the plastic. And so that goes into the tissue, and the tissue tries to cells in to gobble it up, Pac-Man to him up, and eats them, but he can't digest them, so he gets sick and throws up and spews all these factors into the tissue and gets all inflamed and painful and things. So, all right, that's what happened. We're going to revise his hip after 18 years. And went in, lo and behold, there was PBNS there. You couldn't see because the hip replacement was there and the mask. So it's just a concrete example. Cleaned it all out, revised his hip, these 4 years later, it's the happy guy. The final point is sort of where I started on imaging. And when you have such a problem with a joint replacement or issues, that's a problem for imaging. You can't see with MRI. PET scan is not blocked by the and so a PET scan, high radiation, high cost, argument with the insurance company, but it can show, as this lights up like a Christmas tree, that a recurrent disease around joint replacement. So that, with that, you know, went back and solved this problem. But if you don't know what the problem is, you don't have the right diagnosis, you don't have the right imaging, you're flying by the seat of your pants. So thank you for your attention and questions.